Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Queen Cat, Carmel and St Jude Get a Life. Written by Maureen McCarthy and read by Kate Hood. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. The book begins with the following dedication. This one is for Joe, because he asked. Manella, December. Chapter 1. Katrina, you have a choice. University college or a room with your sister. That's final. Well, I won't live with her. Then it's college. Daddy, I've had 6 years of boarding school. I'm 18, for God's sake. Then it's a room with Louise. Katrina took one slim, finely manicured hand out from under the vase she'd been about to fill with her mother's flowers, a lovely smelly heap of white and lilac roses, and deliberately let it slide from her grip. The vase, an antique, made of opaque Waterford crystal which had originally belonged to her grandmother, smashed onto the parquetry floor and sprayed dramatically into a thousand tiny pieces of blue. There was a restrained gasp from her mother and an angry snort from her father. Shocked, the three of them stared mutely at the blue-speckled floor. It was the last straw for Dr. Albert Armstrong. He turned his back to his daughter and snapped the lid of his briefcase down. "You clumsy girl!" "It was an accident," Katrina said defensively. Her father grunted, as though he didn't believe her but had better things to think about. He stepped towards his wife and kissed her brusquely on the cheek. "I'll be home at the usual time, dear." "Yes, dear." He then turned to Katrina, who was still staring at the tiny pieces of glass spread over the floor. "Try to be a help to your mother today, please, Katrina. Don't be worrying her about anything." He didn't wait for her to reply, but strode out the door, closing it stiffly behind him. Katrina looked up, following his retreating shape through the beautiful red and green lead light door leading out into the hall, and wondered why she'd dropped the vase. After all, although she'd given this accommodation business her best shot, she hadn't seriously expected to win. She was only 18, and the main round had been won before the results had come out. That one she'd really insisted on. She wouldn't, simply couldn't, live in a university college. Thankfully, they'd conceded on that one. Just the thought of more institutional food, of lectures and meals, with groups of hearty, giggling girls with bad skin who talked loudly, dressed carelessly, and all their drippy, splotchy-faced boyfriends. Katrina had had enough of that kind of living to last a lifetime. Although it would be another month before she would receive confirmation of a place in law at Melbourne University, her excellent results assured her that there had never been any doubt. She'd won ducks of her prestigious girls' school, plus the French prize and the maths prize. As she turned regretfully to the broken vase, she was reminded of the bitter fight she'd had with her best friend Claire, only 3 months before the end of term.
"You think it's okay to just step on people, don't you, Katrina?"
"What?"
Katrina had been shocked.
"Claire, I simply don't want that dreary girl to come."
That it had been over such a trivial matter made it doubly hard to understand. Claire had suggested inviting some boring girl, whose father had recently carked it, to join them for a day down at Portsea. The girl was a shy, plain, moping type who couldn't even play tennis. She would poison their one free day for sure. How was Katrina to know that her friend would build this disagreement into a raging row?
"You would never consider what she might be going through, would you?"
"What do you mean? What do we owe her?"
But Claire refused to explain herself any further.
"Get a life, Katrina," she'd yelled over her shoulder before storming off. "Just piss off, why don't you, and get a bloody life. Why don't you?"
Katrina had called lamely after her, feeling suddenly sick with remorse and incomprehension. What had she done? It was like now in front of this broken vase. Why did I do this? Claire had been her best friend. They'd laughed together, plotted their futures, told secrets. But in spite of mutual apologies when Claire arrived back at school that evening, Their closeness had ended with that horrible argument. Of course, there was the rest of the crowd, Cara in particular, who'd stepped in to fill the gap. But losing Claire's friendship hurt more than Katerina was prepared to admit. So she would live with her big sister Louise for a year. Never mind, Louise would be in fifth year medicine next year, long hours working in the hospitals, as well as being stuck away every night with her books. With a bit of luck, they wouldn't see each other from one week to the next. My dear, it's spoiling everything, you being like this. Your results were so brilliant. Daddy and I are both so proud. I just wish you wouldn't argue so much. Katerina looked up, a little surprised at her mother's voice. She'd forgotten about her even being there. And here she was in the watery green silk dress that matched her eyes, a slightly surprised, harassed look lining her face. Katerina wondered for perhaps the 20th time that week what she would have to do to make her really mad. Her mother especially valued that blue vase. She knew it. It was a beautiful thing. Katerina was ashamed she'd broken it. Yet her mother had simply stood watching, as usual. Watching while her husband and daughter slugged it out, contained and serene as ever. Why didn't that woman ever do anything? I'm sorry, Mum, about the vase too. It was careless of me. Her mother nodded and sighed again. Well, I do. We both want you to try to accept the situation. Katerina knew her mother was a nice person, a lovely person. Everyone who'd ever met her said so. She was good-looking, refined, warm when she wanted to be, and kind to just about everyone she met. She never seemed to get angry, hardly ever complained. The perfect country surgeon's wife. Katerina tried to remember all the good points about her mother at the same time as imagining walking over and slapping her nicely preserved face very hard on both cheeks. She couldn't help it. It wasn't so much that her mother agreed with everything her father said. It was the way she agreed. So damn demure. You never got the impression she thought anything apart from what he told her to think, or had any ideas apart from his. Katerina walked into the pantry and looked around for the dustpan and brush. Darling, did you remember that the Crossways are coming for dinner tonight? Katerina swallowed her desire to let out a shriek in the small dark room, neatly lined with tins and bottles of fruit and packets of dried food. Instead, she pushed her head around the door and gave her mother a curt nod. The Crossways were her parents' best friends. Her father had studied medicine at university with Neil Crossway eons ago, and the family lived in Yassfield, a small town about 20 kilometres from the Armstrongs. The two men were the district's most senior doctors. They shared work in the same hospital and often rang each other to confer about patients. The Crossway's only son, Anton, had finished his fourth year of law the year before and was now doing his articles with a city firm. Katerina knew that this visit had been arranged on her behalf, that her mother and father thought it was a good idea to reacquaint their daughter with Anton, so she would know someone when she first went to the city. Someone nice, who in turn would introduce her to other nice people. Having located the dustpan and brush, she walked over to the shattered vase and knelt down. The damn thing had spread its tiny pieces into the furthest reaches of the kitchen. "Do I have to be here?" she grumbled, knowing that she did. "Oh, darling, of course you do." Her mother sounded genuinely hurt. "Anton is coming. We thought it might be nice for you to know someone in the city when you arrive." Katerina began sweeping. "Mom, half my year at school will be there. I'll know heaps." "I know, darling, but Anton will know the ropes. And he's someone from home, too." Katerina knew her mother really meant someone like us. Someone from the right kind of family, with plenty of money and the right social connections. Her mother felt a barely contained horror at the thought of either of her children mixing with people who weren't the right sort. The Crossways were loaded. Not only was old Neil a top-earning doctor, but he'd inherited his father's family farm as well, about 3,000 hectares of lush Victorian cattle grazing country. He employed a manager, of course, who lived on the property and looked after it all, as well as locals for seasonal work. Katerina hadn't seen Anton for about 3 years, but remembered him as nice enough, a bit shy and rather good-looking. Katerina smiled to herself as she remembered his diffident tone when she'd asked him a few years ago what he did for fun at uni. He'd only been 18 then, and fairly gauche. He was probably breaking hearts all over the city by this stage. But so what? Whatever he was doing didn't interest her in the least. There was no way she intended seeking out the sons of old family friends for contacts when she hit town. That sort of thing was for people who didn't know who they were, who had no confidence in themselves, no plans. She would be perfectly capable on her own. Katerina swept up most of the glass. There was no point looking too carefully under the table or moving anything. Maria would come later, and she actually seemed to like doing the household tasks she was paid to do. Okay, I'll be here. Katerina sighed as she moved over to look out of the kitchen window, onto the patio and lush backyard. Her family home was a rambling, beautifully restored Edwardian house, set on the highest hill above the main street of the busy country town of Manella. The many big trees sheltered the garden from any neighbouring houses or roads. Except for the birds, all was quiet. The garden sloped slightly down to the back fence, which was lined with enormous liquid ambers and maples, all green and yellow shade now, rustling in the foul north wind. Katerina could see the old rope hanging down from what used to be her branch on her favourite tree in the corner. The hours she and Louise used to put in down there, hiding from each other in their separate trees, swinging on the rope, pretending they were world-class gymnasts or female Tarzans. A perfect childhood. Until the day her eldest sister, her hero, best friend and constant companion, had been wrenched away from her. Well, that's how it had felt anyway. Sent off to boarding school at 14, when Katerina had been only 10. That first year of being the only child in the big house was the worst time Katerina could remember. Waking up every morning with Louise gone was like being cut each day in the same spot. Life, which until then had been wonderful, full of jokes, excitement, and interesting plans with Louise, became simply a matter of filling in time until Lulu could come back. It was a much worse feeling than her own first year at boarding school, because by then she'd learnt to rely on herself and not to care. Of course, her sister had come home for weekends and holidays, but things were never the same between them. The truth was that Louise hadn't missed her little sister much at all. This was obvious the first weekend she came home, and it had been a bitter pill for the 10-year-old Katerina to swallow. Her sister had made new friends, had new ways of looking at things. She wasn't interested in the old games anymore. Katerina sighed again when she noticed the leaves from the sugar gum swirling around in the swimming pool. Her father had asked her to clean it out yesterday, but she'd forgotten. The high sun shone down onto the iridescent blue water, making a stinging brightness so different from the muted, easy tones of the surrounding trees. She would have a swim later, but not before that wind had subsided. "Don't be upset, dear," her mother said, mistaking her sombre musing for further sulking about the housing issue. Surprised by the concerned voice, Katerina turned around to face her mother with a dazzling smile. "I'm not, Mum, really." Katerina took her arm. The relief on her mother's face made her feel slightly queasy. Katerina vowed for the millionth time never to get herself into her mother's situation. "Never, never will I be dependent on other people for how I feel about myself, about anything. I will never be at someone else's mercy." "Don't worry, Mum, it'll be fine." Her mother pulled her briefly against the cool green silk of her breast and whispered into her hair. "You sure?" "Of course." Katerina was really just a younger version of her mother. They shared the same lightly tanned, creamy skin, the fair curly hair and the green eyes. Both were slender and straight with well-proportioned figures and dainty hands and feet. The older woman, almost 50 now, was entering middle age gracefully, the tiny crow's feet around her eyes and the slight greying of her hair adding to her charm and dignified beauty. Katerina had the same grace and charm about her body, But her face, although very similar to her mother's, was livelier. They were both beautiful. Katrina felt a sudden rush, an almost physical burst of gratitude towards the woman standing in front of her. There had been other attractive girls at her school, but they were in the main dark-haired, sultry types or brassy, cheap-looking blondes. Cute, perhaps, in a way, but the kind of looks that ultimately faded into mere prettiness. None of them, she knew, quite matched herself. "Mom, that green really suits you," Katrina said softly, pulling away from her mother's embrace, but still holding her hand. Mrs. Armstrong gave a smile.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.